To get started, let's wipe the slate clean and load in a brand new dynamesh 128 project. Open up Lightbox by pressing the comma key and double-click the dynamesh 128 project icon to load the project. ZBrush is going to ask if we want to save our current project, and in this case, there's nothing I really want to keep from our practice sculpt, so I'll click No, and here is our fresh project loaded up. Now let's take this opportunity to introduce a bit more of our ZBrush work environment. So far, we've been focusing on our sculpting area, which is our canvas, as well as the brushes, materials, and color palettes here on the left side, and also our brush settings here at the top. Now, you've probably noticed this area here on the right. This area is called the tray. The tray can be opened or closed by clicking once on the arrows here, which will allow us to view more of our canvas to focus on sculpting. Here inside of the tray, we have our tool palette. The tool palette is simply one of many other menus in ZBrush, which can be found listed here at the top. Now, the tool palette holds all of our 3D objects in our sculpting project. Within the tool palette, we have all of these sub-palettes or sub-menus that hold other features used for modifying our surface, adding details, and all kinds of applications related to the tool itself. Now, a tool is just a term that we use to describe the 3D object that we're working with. A tool can consist of multiple 3D objects, which we'll discuss later in this series. To get started, we're going to pick an area to focus on to start to build off of as we move through the sculpting process. So I'll start off by choosing one of our core brushes to start dropping in some shape. The Move brush is an excellent brush to start shaping the mesh. Let's select it by pressing the B key on the keyboard and find it in the menu quickly and selecting it. Keeping in mind the hammerhead shark shape, I'm going to start pushing in and flattening down the mesh and start to rotate around at different angles to get a nice silhouette as well as good proportions for the head. Constantly changing the draw size as well as scaling further away from the mesh will allow me to move larger areas to quickly break away from the spherical shape. So the clay buildup brush is an excellent brush to use for sketching in some form and base details. So I'll switch my brush by selecting it, and we'll press the B key on the keyboard and find it in the brush palette inside of our quick pick brush menu. So this area here is shaping up to be the base of the mouth. So I'll go in with the clay buildup brush to carve out an area that will define the lips. It's easy to quickly carve out the shape of the mouth by pressing Alt, as well as building up around where the lips are. Don't forget about our smooth option, so press and hold the Shift key to smooth the surface just a bit if the sculpt starts to get a little messy. Now, as I'm laying in these defining lines here, I'll switch to the standard brush by finding it in my quick pick brush menu, and now I can go in with a more controlled brush stroke to sculpt in a line around the lips. And again, I'll press and hold the Alt key to carve inside of the mouth to start creating more definition between these two surfaces. I can also adjust the Z intensity of the standard brush by pressing the U key on the keyboard and adjust the strength of the brush stroke higher. So now we can go in and add to these surfaces with a stronger application. I'll knock back some of the details to keep my surface clean, and let's switch over to the Move brush now to start pushing and pulling again to refine the shape further. Now, I want to quickly go back and take a look at our reference image of the hammerhead shark. So let's navigate to the see-through slider here at the top and adjust the slider to a high enough level of transparency to see our image. I want to try and mimic the portion that connects the mouth area here to the hammer shape, which will eventually also hold the eyes. So without letting the image dictate my sculpt too much, I'd like to exaggerate the distance between the mouth and the eyes a bit to give my character more of a friendly appearance. So we'll turn off the see-through option by setting the slider back to zero. Now, in order to pull this shape up to connect the base of the head to what will be the eyes, let's use the Move brush again with a fairly large draw size to pull this area up quickly and start to shape. Remember to always rotate around the mesh, as well as scaling away from the mesh for more effective shaping. Now, this isn't perfect by any means, but it's looking okay for now. So let's move on to tackle getting the hammer shape pulled out here at the top, to start defining where we will be placing one of the major focal points of the character, which are the eyes. Now, of course, we can continue to use the move brush in this case, but as I start to pull away from the mesh, depending on the size of the brush, this can also start to pull the base along with it here at the top, which is starting to change the shape in a way that I don't like. So in order to fix this or make this a little bit easier for myself, we could adjust the brush size to be smaller and go in and pull outwards. But in order to save time sculpting and refining this area, let's take this opportunity to talk about using a different method to better isolate this area by using a different type of brushes called masking brushes. By pressing and holding the Control key on the keyboard, for those on the Macintosh, press and hold the Command key, notice the brush palette icon switches to the masking brushes icon. By clicking on the icon, here is a new set of brushes called masking brushes. So think of it similar to the smooth brush. Similarly, how the Shift key will isolate the smooth brush and allow us to smooth our mesh, the Control key will isolate these masking brushes. To create a mask, press and hold the Control key. For those on the Macintosh, press and hold the Command key and drag your cursor on the canvas. Now, this will draw a rectangle over the mesh. By letting go of our cursor, we have now created a mask on the surface. So this dark gray area here is our mask. To clear a mask, press and hold the Control key and drag your cursor on the canvas, and this will clear the mask. Be sure to let go of your cursor when you drag on the canvas to clear. Now, in order to use our masking brushes with more control on the surface, I'll make sure my draw size is a bit smaller here, and now press and hold the Control key again, which in this case will allow me to draw a mask on the mesh based on our brush. Be sure that if your intention is to draw a custom mask on the surface, when pressing and holding the Control key to access the mask brush, that you are drawing on the surface and not clicking on the canvas, which will access the rectangle selection. So you're probably wondering at this point, what does masking do? When an area on the mesh is masked, it will create a shield over this area and protect it from deforming or sculpting on this area. If we let go of the Control key, the brush will change back to our sculpting brushes, and we can now try to sculpt with the move brush, for example, and as you can see that the sculpting brush won't affect this area, and will allow me to use the move brush to pull this area around the mask. Now let's say we wanted to inverse the mask or reverse the way that it's selected on the mesh. To inverse the mask area and focus our sculpting only in this area, press and hold the Control key and click once on the canvas. Be sure to click only on the canvas and not on the mesh itself to inverse the mask. Now, alternatively, we can use the keyboard shortcut to inverse the mask by pressing Control I on the keyboard, or for those on the Macintosh, press Command I. Now that we've inversed the mask, we can add and subtract from this specific area for added flexibility. Okay, so let's press Ctrl Z a couple times to undo those sculpting actions. And now let's go in and erase a portion of the mask. To erase the mask, press and hold Ctrl and Alt on the keyboard. For those on the Macintosh, press Command and Alt. And by painting over the mask on the surface, this will erase the mask. So by drawing in a mask, we can start to define some sort of shape here, and then refine it or reshape it by either erasing some of the mask or adding to it, and now sculpt around the mask for added controls. Or, if needed, we can inverse by pressing Ctrl-I or Command-I on the keyboard, or pressing and holding Ctrl and clicking once on the canvas. Using masking, we can create all different kinds of shapes within an area for added flexibility with the sculpting process. Now, don't worry, we're going to discuss some of these kinds of applications with the mask brushes further into the sculpting process. For now, we'll just focus on the basics. Thanks for visiting Z Classroom, and I'll see you in the next video.